Greetings. Thank you, brother, for your follow-up post. It has taken some time to respond to your comment. Matthew 26:39. He, Jesus, went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed. The point of this post is to attempt to imply that Jesus was Muslim, because Jesus prayed like a Muslim. In part D of this series, I referenced the following verse. John 17:1. Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may also glorify you. Then I made the following comment. Jesus lifted up his eyes to heaven to pray. Jesus did not pray with his forehead on the ground like a worthless slave. I appreciate the dedication and commitment Muslims have to their beliefs, no matter how wrong they are. I think Christians have much to learn about being serious about their faith. So this dedicated slave of Mohammed posted the following. Matthew 26:39. He, Jesus, went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed. That's it. Short and sweet. To the point. He, Jesus, went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed. A Muslim tries to make this point, imagining Muslims fall on their face when they pray. But if that were the case, prayer injuries would be very common. Just for grins, Google Muslim prayer injuries falling on face. Results? Zero. Zip. Zilch. Nada. None. None from falling. But there is an interesting bump or abrasion called zabiba, Arabic for raisin or prayer bump. Similar to a repetitive motion injury, there is a repetitive pressure damage to forehead skin. From https://maranchi.com from 2012, December 11th, prayer bumps. Muslims pray five times a day, and as part of the Muslim prayer, Salah, the Muslim prostrates and touches the ground with his or her forehead and nose, the sujud. The article proceeds to inform the reader that in doing so, millions of Muslims develop what in Islamic jargon is called zabiba, Arabic for raisin, or a prayer bump. In other words, the repeated pressure of the head on the prayer mat will produce a discoloration of the skin in the area of contact, and in some cases apparently provoking a bump. Notice it is repeated pressure, not impact, not striking the ground. You won't find that, because Muslims do not fall before, during, or after prayer, unless they're drunk, which Muhammad told them in his Quran not to do. Surah 4:43, believers, do not attempt to pray while you are in a state of drunkenness. Muhammad did not mention they would fall on their face and hurt themselves, but he did helpfully tell them how to know if they were still drunk. But wait until you know what you are saying. We have no way to know if the original Quran foretold facial injuries, but Uthman's revision appears to have removed these clear reasons, these clear signs from Allah. Just understand, Muhammad desperately tried to claim Jesus, the Son of God, was a prophet of Mohammedism, which spawned an Islamic industry of silly arguments, right next door to the ministry of silly walks. One bad argument invented over the ages is that Jesus fell on his face to pray. Thus he was a Muslim, probably drunk and unable to just kneel like all other Muslims. This is the depth and breadth and height of the best of Islamic thinking on full display. So let's look at the context. That is where arguments for Islam typically fall on their face. I know, I couldn't resist. Matthew 26:31. Then Jesus said to them, All of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. So the context is that this is the night Jesus is to be betrayed. Notice Jesus says, for it is written. And the quotes, Jesus is reciting a prophet talking about Jesus. It's actually Zechariah 13:7. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who is my companion, declares Jehovah, the Lord of hosts. Jehovah God speaking through prophet Zechariah. He calls for a sword against his shepherd. Calling for the sword could mean a literal sword, or could be a metaphor for violence. If I was a Muslim hoping to ignore and dismiss the context, that's the argument I would make. Jesus was not killed by a sword. But that jihad falls for one huge reason. Jesus did not apply that phrase about the sword to himself. Jesus was miraculously precise about which words he applied from the prophets. But let's continue examining Zechariah 13:7. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who is my companion. Jehovah God calls this man his shepherd, his companion. In Islam, the companions of Muhammad were quite important. A companion knows the principal party face-to-face, BFF-like. Yet Jehovah God's statement is to call for a sword against, to strike down, his shepherd, his companion. John 10:11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Jesus referred to himself as a shepherd, as the good shepherd, many times. Take a moment and marvel at the coherent message of the prophets and the coherent plan of Jehovah God. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Jehovah God foretold, Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who is my companion, declares Jehovah, the Lord of hosts. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered, and I will turn my hand against the little ones. This is the portion Jesus recites and applies to himself. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. Then Jesus said to them, All of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. Yet again, Jesus, the Messiah, the Lamb of God, the Son of Man, is foretelling his death and resurrection. Elsewhere, Jesus refers to the crucifixion as being lifted up. John 12:32, And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself. This he said, signifying by what death he would die. He's not talking about being lifted up to heaven after his resurrection. John 3:14, Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. John 12:34. The crowd replied, We have heard from the law that the Christ will remain forever. So how can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? So lifted up implies crucified, crucifixion. Acts 2:24. But God raised him from the dead, releasing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its clutches. Acts 2:32. God has raised this Jesus to life, to which we are all witnesses. Acts 3:15. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead, and we are witnesses of the fact. Acts 4:10. Then let this be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel. It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. 2 Timothy 2:8. Remember that Jesus Christ, of the seed of David, was raised from the dead, according to my gospel. So, lifted up implies crucified, crucifixion. Raised up means resurrection. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. So, in this context of a verse Muslims hope to imply Jesus is a Muslim, Jesus' own words teach non-Islamic truths. Jesus confirms his death and his resurrection from the dead. Peter answered and said to him, "Even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble." Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you that this night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples. You can hear the murmur. Me too. Yeah, yeah. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." And he took with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me." He went a little further and fell on his face and prayed. And this is the verse Islam teaches to rip out of context. And not even the whole verse, just a phrase. Because the whole verse damns Islam's lie, saying, "Oh my Father," Jesus, knowing his coming death on the cross, calls God my Father. Jesus prays to his Father in heaven. God is his Father. "If it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Jesus knows the will of God, foretold by the prophets, was to die on the cross for the sins of Israel and all mankind. This is why Islam does not dare to read the whole verse. Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping and said to Peter, "What? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." No mention of ritual Islamic washing. No mention of kneeling, and then purposefully bending at the waist until the forehead alone gently touches the ground. Again a second time, he went away and prayed, saying, "Oh my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done." Islam does not dare to read the context. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. So he left them, went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Do not listen to the lies of Islam that Jesus prayed like a Muslim prays. A Muslim prays by gently kneeling in a controlled lowering of the body to rest on the knees, not the face. Then purposefully bending at the waist until their forehead alone gently touches the ground. Muslims do not fall on their face by any stretch of the terms. And the Son of God did not pray like a slave of Mohammed in Mohammadism. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.